I'm working on a longer video at the moment, but in the meantime, here's a shorter one about a two-variable function where the limit as x and y approach 0 exists and is the same along every straight line path to 0, but the two-variable limit doesn't exist. Let me give some background first. If you have a function of one variable, let's call it fx, then even if the function is not defined at 0, you can take a limit as x approaches 0. For example, the function sine x over x at x equals 0 has the value 0 divided by 0, which is not defined. But if we take the limit as x approaches 0, we get 1. Formalizing this is a bit messy, but let's not bother with that because we can clearly see from the graph that the limit has to be 1. Now, if the limit is infinite or different from either side, then we say it doesn't exist. For example, this function, x divided by the absolute value of x, is equal to 1 for positive x and negative 1 for negative x. So the right-hand limit is 1 and the left-hand limit is negative 1, meaning the overall limit as x approaches 0 doesn't exist. We get a similar situation for functions of two variables. Here's a function where the limit does exist, and the limit as x and y both approach 0 is 1. Once again, formalizing this is a bit messy, but you can see from the graph that there's no funny business going on around 0. There is a hole in the middle, which is due to my graphing calculator freaking out when it tries to compute 0 divided by 0. Look, it's trying its hardest, okay? Here's a function where the limit doesn't exist. If we approach 0 along the line y equals x, then the function simplifies to x squared over 2x squared, which is equal to a half for every non-zero value of x, meaning the limit equals 1 half. However, if we approach 0 along the line y equals negative x, then we get the same thing but with a minus sign, and so the limit equals minus 1 half. Since these two paths disagree, the limit doesn't exist. We can see this on the graph as well. Approaching 0 along one of the lines diagonal to the axes gives a positive number, while the other diagonal gives a negative number. Now this is where a lecturer would normally say, be careful. You can use this method to show that a limit doesn't exist, but you can't go the other way. You can't check different directions and show they are the same in order to prove that the limit exists. To start off, here's a very simple counterexample. Take the function x squared over x squared plus y squared, and let's test the same two paths that we tested on the previous function. With y equals x, we get a half, and with y equals minus x, we again get a half. Does this prove that the limit exists? No, and you can clearly see from the graph that the limit doesn't exist. If we picked another path, such as y equals 0, we get a different result. The limit instead approaches 1. Okay, so that's certainly a counterexample, but it leads to an obvious follow-up question. If checking two lines is not enough, what if we check more? What if we check all the lines? We could write a straight line through 0 in the form y equals mx, where m is the slope. Is it enough to check the limit for every value of m? The answer is still no, and here is a counterexample. Y to the 4 over x squared plus y to the 4. Let's plug in y equals mx and take the limit as x approaches 0. We can cancel out some x's, and now the numerator approaches 0 while the denominator approaches 1, meaning this limit exists and equals 0. This works for every value of m, including m equals 0. So does the two-variable limit exist? Well, if we take a look at the graph, we can see that no, it doesn't. And we can also see where we went wrong. There's one straight line through 0 that can't be written in the form y equals mx, and that's the line x equals 0, for which the slope is infinite. If we check this path, we get a different value. But I still find this unsatisfying. I want an example where the limit fails to exist even when every straight line path, including x equals 0, gives the same limit. Is this even possible? Well, there's one relatively simple answer. Define the function f to have the value 1 whenever x equals y squared and 0 otherwise. This is not really possible to show on the graphing calculator, so let me just draw it by hand. There we are. The function is equal to 1 only on an infinitely thin parabolic line. If we approach 0 from this side, we obviously get a limit of 0. If we go along a straight line on this side, there is always a point where we cross the parabola, and everything after that point is 0, so once again the limit is 0. And finally, if we approach tangentially to the parabola, that is, along the line x equals 0, we never reach the parabola before reaching the center, so the limit is still 0. So that's it. That's the counterexample. But it's not a great counterexample, is it? I mean, this kind of piecewise function, it's not natural. It's not the sort of function you would expect to find in the wild. Oh, hey look. A function. We can do better. let's find a rational function, which means a polynomial divided by a polynomial. Here's a little trick I came up with. Consider this single variable function, where the number a is just a positive constant. It looks like a hump, and importantly, if we decrease the value of a, the hump gets skinnier, and as a approaches 0, we can make the hump arbitrarily thin. The idea is as follows. We're going to build a two-variable function out of slices that look like this hump, but we're going to do it in such a way that the tip of the hump follows a parabola, and the hump gets thinner as we get closer to 0. That way, we'll get a rational function, which looks more and more like this piecewise function as x and y approach 0. To make the hump follow a parabola, I'm going to replace x with x minus y squared. To make the hump get thinner with y, I could let a equal something like y squared, but it turns out to make this work just right, we need the hump to thin out very quickly, so I'm going to replace a with y to the 6. Once again, my graphing calculator is struggling a bit, but that's okay, we just need to check the limits by hand. First, let y equal mx, and take the limit as x approaches 0. We can cancel out x squared, and now the numerator approaches 0 while the denominator approaches 1, meaning the limit equals 0. Good so far. Let's also note that this even works if m equals 0. And now the moment of truth. Let's check the last special line, x equals 0. After getting rid of the x's, you can now see why we needed y to the power of 6, because after cancelling out y to the 4, we once again have a situation where the numerator approaches 0 while the denominator approaches 1. So the limit is 0 along every straight line path. But it is not 0 along the curved path x equals y squared, for if we plug in x equals y squared, we get y to the 6 over y to the 6, which approaches 1. We did it! We found a rational function which tricks us on every straight line. You might now be thinking, what if you check every curved path? It turns out checking every continuous curved path is enough to prove that the limit exists. Specifically, if the limit doesn't exist, then there must be a sequence of points approaching 0 disagreeing with the limit, and we can just draw a curved path through them. Probably the best way to check every path at once would be to convert to polar coordinates and allow the angle to be an arbitrary function of the radius. If the function you're working with is particularly nice and lets you cancel things out, then this can take care of everything in a single blow. A lot of the arguments we've been working with here are correct, but pretty informal. If you want a much more rigorous way of understanding when a limit does or doesn't exist, you should use the epsilon delta definition of the limit, which is why you should pay attention in your real analysis class. Because, I don't know, you never know when you might stumble across a function in the wild that tries to deceive you with its straight line limits.